Hello everyone. We have already published different visual mnemonic books. Please visit our website www.medinas.com for your copy. It will definitely help you in your studies. Thank you. Today we will discuss about temporomandibular joint anatomy. Temporomandibular joint, certainly one of the most complex joints in the body. It is considered as ganglimoarthroidal joint. Ganglimoid joint because it provides hinging movement in one plane. However, at the same time, it also provides gliding movements. That's why it is called arthroidal joint. Here you can see the TMJ. This is condyle and this bony prominence is the articular eminence. And this blue one is disc. Hinging or rotation movement is done in the lower compartment of the joint and gliding is done in the upper compartment of the joint. The rotation is always in forward and downward direction. The TMJ is formed by the mandibular condyle and the mandibular fossa of the temporal bone. Here you can see the temporal bone and here is the condyle. The articular disc separates these two bones from direct articulation. Here I would like to share an interesting point that the TMJ is classified as a compound joint. By definition, a compound joint requires the presence of at least three bones. Yet, the TMJ is made up of only two bones. Functionally, the articular disc serves as a non-ossified bone, which permits the complex movement of the joint. So functionally, articular disc acts as a third bone here. That's why it is considered as a compound joint. Now let's see the different bony parts of TMJ. The articular disc is composed of dense fibrous connective tissue and most part devoid of any blood vessels or nerve fibers. This point you should remember for competitive exams that it is composed of fibrocartilage, not hyaline cartilage. The extreme periphery of the disc, however, is slightly innervated. In the sagittal plane, it can be divided into three regions according to the thickness. The central area is the thinnest and is called the intermediate zone. The disc becomes considerably thicker both anterior and posterior to the intermediate zone. In the normal joint, the articular surface of the condyle is located on the intermediate zone of the disc. The precise shape of the disc is determined by the morphology of the condyle and mandibular fossa. The disc maintains its morphology unless destructive forces or structural changes occur in the joint. If these changes occur, the morphology of the disc can be irreversibly altered and produce biomechanical changes during function. The articular disc is attached posterior to a region of loose connective tissue that is highly vascularized and innervated. This tissue is known as the retrodiscal tissue or posterior attachment. Superiorly, it is bordered by a lamina of connective tissue that contains many elastic fibers. The superior retrodiscal lamina. The superior retrodiscal lamina attaches the articular disc posteriorly to the tympanic plate. At the lower border of the retrodiscal tissue is the inferior retrodiscal lamina, which attaches the inferior border of the posterior edge of the disc to the posterior margin of the articular surface of the condyle. Here, you should remember that the inferior retrodiscal lamina is composed of chiefly collagen fibers, not elastic fibers like superior retrodiscal lamina. The remaining body of the retrodiscal tissue is attached posteriorly to a large venous plexus which fills with blood as the condyle moves forward. The superior and inferior attachments of the anterior region of the disc are to the capsular ligament which surround most of the joint. The superior attachment is to the anterior margin of the articular surface of the temporal bone and the inferior attachment to the anterior margin of the articular surface of the condyle. Both these anterior attachments are composed of collagen fibers. Anteriorly, between the attachment of the capsular ligament The disc is also attached by the tendinous fiber to the superior lateral pterygoid muscle. The articular disc is attached to the capsular ligament anteriorly, posteriorly, medially, and laterally. This divides the joint into two distinct cavities, the upper or superior cavity and lower or inferior cavity. The superior cavity is bordered by the mandibular fossa and the superior surface of the disc, and the lower or inferior cavity is bordered by the mandibular condyle and the inferior surface of the disc. The internal surface of the cavities are surrounded by a specialized endothelial cells which produces synovial fluid which fills both the joint cavities. It has mainly two functions. It provides nutrition and it acts as a lubricant and reduces the function during articular movement. The synovial membrane consists of macrophage-like type A cells and fibroblast-like type B cells, which is identical to those in the other joints. Synovial fluid is a filtrate of plasma with added mucins and proteins. Its main constituent is hyaluronic acid. Synovial fluid lubricates the articular surface by way of two mechanisms. One is boundary lubrication and the other is whipping lubrication. You should remember that the boundary lubrication is the primary mechanism of joint lubrication. Now, let's discuss about the nerve supply or innervation of TMJ. Most innervation is provided by the auriculotemporal nerve as it leaves the mandibular nerve behind the joint and ascends laterally and superiorly to wrap around the posterior region of the joint. Other two nerves, deep temporal and mesenteric, supply the anterior portion of TMJ. Now the vascular supply. Vascular supply of TMJ is mainly done by superficial temporal artery, middle meningeal artery, and internal maxillary artery. Other important arteries like deep auricular, anterior tympanic, and ascending pharyngeal also supply the TMJ. TMJ has three functional ligaments for support: the collateral ligament, the capsular ligament, and the temporomandibular ligament. And there are two accessory ligaments, the sphenomandibular ligament and stylomandibular ligament. In the next video, we'll discuss in detail about the ligaments.